Thank you all for coming. This is Sauron, do-it-yourself home security using Ruby. My name is Jonan. I go by Leetbot on the internet, on Twitter. If you aren't able to read that Twitter handle, then maybe you should look up on Wikipedia LeetSpeak. It's an old people joke that's not very funny to begin with. But you just can think of me as the guy who's really hard to find on Twitter. You have to be really dedicated to want to follow me. It's just a bunch of numbers. I'm from Portland. It is a beautiful city. You should come visit in the spring. Anytime in the spring or summer, great times to visit Portland. They call me webmaster. I am the webmaster for the Cedar Hills Kindergarten and Preschool. It's a co-op where my son works. It's a pretty important gig. Mostly I manage mailing lists, adding people to mailing lists, taking people off mailing lists. If you have any mailing list related questions, you can reach me at webmaster@cedarhillskp.org. I have another side gig at this company called New Relic, where I work on a project called New Relic RPM, which is the Ruby agent, the gem that you all install to get New Relic instrumentation for your applications. So if it's broken, call someone else. If you want to compliment the code, come and talk to me. If you're ever in Portland, come and visit. I would love to take you out to lunch at the carts across the street, and we'll go sit up there on the 29th floor of our fancy building and look out at the skyline. It's beautiful. If you were up in Portland for RailsConf, you probably saw our office. We had a party up there a couple years ago. But if you're in Portland, I'm going to be upset if you don't come calling. You'll have to find me on Twitter first. If you are at all interested in becoming one of us and drinking the New Relic Kool-Aid, you can go to bit.ly nerdlife, or you can just talk to me. This is a list of jobs that were open at one point, and many still are, but there are also other jobs. I don't know. There are links on the site. I'm sure you'll find your way around. But if you have any questions, feel free to ask me. And in particular, we are looking for a Ruby agent engineer, someone to work on our team with us to metaprogram every Rails app in the world in really abhorrent ways. So if you are interested in that kind of thing, come and talk to me. It would be nice to meet you. So I want to talk to you all about my knife set to start off here. This is a talk about kitchen knives, as it turns out. This is my kitchen knife set. It's really nice, actually. I'm pretty pleased with it. I have a lot of Ruby friends who are big into cooking. Ryan Davis, for one, has a nice set of Schoon knives. And he once bragged to me that he took them to the manufacturer to get sharpened, and they were so sharp that it took all the hair off his arm when he dragged it along his arm, and several layers of skin. But I prefer my kitchen knives in like a not accidentally amputate anything sort of way. So I like these ones. These are good knives. They've made me very happy. And they're especially cheap, which is the nicest thing about these kitchen knives, because my children literally eat $100 bills for breakfast. This is a picture of my children eating $100 bills. Everyone thinks I'm joking when I say that. They're little monsters, right? So I love my knives. They're cheap, but I take good care of them. I've got some sharpening stones. My friend Rain gave me one, and I got another one, so I can sharpen my knives and keep them in fine order. And they're kind of important to me. It is a nice kitchen possession to have a good set of knives. And occasionally, we end up in a situation like this, where the knives are left in the sink to rust in the water, sometimes with filth on them. And I know that I am not the one doing it, right? Because I don't do wrong things, generally speaking. And my wife, of course, insists that it is not her. So there's only really one reasonable conclusion to be drawn, and I'm sure we're all thinking the same thing. It's Sauron, right? Sauron likes knives and home invasion. So clearly, Sauron is coming into my home to spread evil in the world by dirtying my knives and leaving them in the sink. And I had to solve this problem, right? So I came up with the solution. And I've trademarked that. I'm still talking to Groupon about it. Their lawyers are after me. But I think it's going to work out just fine. So I'm going to talk to you today about the solution and kind of tell the story of how I built this monster and what all went into it and show you a little bit of the architecture. But let's start with the name, right? I decided to name it Sauron. It's going to be a gem. The first bit that lives on the device that's taking pictures is going to be a gem called Sauron. And then I went, after starting my project and writing a fair bit of code, I went to Ruby Gems and found this squatter on my name for some definition of squatter where it means legitimate, useful, valuable project. And they stole my name, and it was really important for my do-it-yourself home security system. But I got over it. I got a new name. I decided to call it All Seeing Eye, which is actually more to the point, I think, right? That's what I'm building, is an All Seeing Eye. And then, after writing some more code, you'd think I would have learned my lesson. But no, I went to Ruby Gems later and someone is squatting again with a useful project that does things. And finally, I settled on the perfect name, which I should have thought of in the first place, which is All Seeing Pi, duh, because it's a Raspberry Pi. I have a Raspberry Pi with a little camera on it and a gem that runs on the Pi and takes pictures, and so it's the All Seeing Pi. So this is, yes, slow clap for the All Seeing Pi. This is a Raspberry Pi. If anyone hasn't heard of them, they're little itty-bitty computers about the size of a credit card, and they're fantastic, and they're super fun to hook up to all sorts of things. This is actually a very simple use of a Raspberry Pi. There are a lot more interesting things you can do with them than this. But you can buy this little camera for them. This is a Raspberry Pi cam. It plugs right in behind the Ethernet port on the Pi, and then it takes pictures. There's a little command line utility you can use called Raspi Still. It takes a picture and stores it to the hard drive, little JPEGs. You can do whatever you want with it. So in my case, because Sauron is wily and probably spot the camera right away, I want to immediately get the images to the clouds, right? So when the camera takes a picture, I push it into the clouds of Mordor service provider and store my images up in the cloud, right? And then I have another piece that's going to consume that information. But the point there is that I want the Pi to do as little as possible because they're tiny computers and they aren't very fast. So you want to offload as much as you can, obviously, in the beginning. So I have this other app called Palantir. And the Palantir app is to do all of the other things that need to happen. So the Pi only exists to take pictures, and the all-seeing Pi gem is to run on the Pi in a simple script and just take pictures and upload them to the clouds, right? So naturally, Palantir is written in Rails because we all remember the Lord of the Rings train from the Lord of the Rings movies. You guys remember this train, I'm sure. Trains were a big theme in Lord of the Rings. This one has an Eye of Sauron on the front and a laser, I think, coming out of the Eye of Sauron. So I had to build it in Rails, right? I was pretty set on Rails. And then I have the All-Seeing Pi, right? It's my gem here. So I want to talk a little bit about how the All-Seeing Pi is put together first. So it's pretty simple. It takes a picture from the camera, again, using a command line utility, stores it locally on the hard drive, and then pushes it to the cloud, and then deletes the local one, because I don't want to just fill up the Pi. I mean, there's a reasonable amount of space. You've got an SD card on there. You can get a big SD card and store a bunch of images, but better to just put them up in the clouds and then forget about the local versions, and so I delete them as I go, and I upload to the cloud. And then the idea was that I was going to have this Palantir app, and it was going to pull, I guess, the storage, the cloud storage, and wait for new images, right? And pulling is kind of terrible. You don't want to do that if you don't have to, usually, because it wastes a lot of resources, and there are some timing issues that can come along, and like maybe I'm getting more images or images more often than I'm pulling, and it became something of a question for me in my initial architecture. So I decided that what I would do to kick off this collection of images was that I would have the Pi, the Raspberry Pi, push a thing into a queue, right? We could have this queue here, and we can push a message onto the queue, and then the app on the other end will pick up the image and do what it needs to do, right? So Palantir will carry on with its life based on this kind of little eventing system that uses a queue. But everyone knows that queue doesn't belong in this universe, actually. The Lord of the Rings application does not need any queues. So I decided against the queue because it's basically kind of a bad form of a simple API that I could just build instead. And it took me a while to get to that conclusion, but I decided that what I would do instead is I would take the picture with the camera, and then I would have a little API hit that just sent the URL over to Palantir, and their Palantir would know that it had received a new image, and it would take over from there. And my thought was, I want to keep this very simple, right? I want the bits of Ruby that are running on the Pi to do almost nothing, right? They upload a picture, and then they send a little post with an image create over to the Palantir application. So interestingly, those URLs can be kind of handy because they include the directory name, where I can go and look for the image from the other app, and they include the key name for the image itself. So I could, from the URL, store all of that information on my Palantir side by extracting it from the URL and then using it to do the rest of the calculations that I have. But again, I'm still with this situation where Palantir is going to have to download the images because we're going to want to compare these images somehow, right? So Palantir is going to need to compare local copies of those images to hash them. And in order to do that, I'm going to have to be pulling them down whether I'm getting this API hit or not. So the keep it simple plan fell apart, and I just got to keep it everything plan instead, where I just send everything over. Because this is all the information that we really need. And if I send it all over to the Palantir application, then I don't have to actually go and download the images at all, which is fantastic, right? So in here we have evilcloud.co, and then the image name is where the image is stored, and then the name is the key in the bucket or directory online. Then we have this p-hash thing that I'm going to explain here, and the directory itself is called doom, right? So the p-hash, it's a perceptual hash. Have people heard of perceptual hashes by show of hands? This is a thing people know of? Good. I'm actually really glad that I get to explain this. A perceptual hash is defined here as a fingerprint of a multimedia file derived from various features of its content, which is correct and also more complicated than maybe I would say. I would go with a number. A p-hash is a number. So it looks like this, and it is a number, as you can see. And there's a way that we get these numbers. When we take an image, we turn them into numbers using this magical p-hashing algorithm. And there are actually a lot of different ways to do this and do it faster or slower, but this is one way that it is done. So first you take the Eye of Sauron, and with no regard for anything, you just smash it, right? We smash it down to 8 pixels by 8 pixels, and then we have 64 little pixels of color. And we're going to use this to build up that fingerprint, that number we were just talking about. So we take those 64 pixels and we turn them gray. So now we only have 64 color values instead of thrice that many, right? And so we end up with this grayscale image where we have 64 different shades of gray all the way across. And that's not the book. I wasn't referencing the book. I'm told that's like the programmer version of 64 shades of gray. Okay. So this is the image on the left, the grayscale image. And on the right, what they've done is you take a mean value for all of these gray pixels. And then if it's bigger, you turn it black. And if it's lower, you turn it white. And so you end up with this binary distribution of black and white. And it still kind of looks like an eye if you look at it, right? That looks sort of like the Eye of Sauron that we've smashed down. And so we can take that then and go through the image starting at the top left corner and just give bit values to each of those, right? And as we go across the image assigning these bit values, we end up with a 64-bit number generated from this image initially. And it's pretty fast, right? We smashed it to 8 pixels, we turned it grayscale, and then we changed them all by that mean number that we got, right? This is a quick thing. You can do it fairly fast. And if you look at this kind of squinty, you can see the shape of the eye still in the binary on the right. Right? So this binary, if we interpret it as an integer, then we 2i2 it right here in Ruby, and we that's how Ruby works. I don't know. You use an orange arrow and a 2i2, and then you get this integer on the right side. And that's our Hamming distance, or I'm sorry, that's our perceptual hash. I spoiled the next part. So we're going to use those perceptual hashes to compare the images and decide how an image has changed. We're going to detect changes in the images, right? Again, this is your last warning. I'm about to turn on a device that may take pictures of you and put them on the internet. So if you're on this side of the room and would like to not be on the internet, move to this side of the room. You have 3 seconds. Okay, nothing exciting is happening yet. Maybe it's happening. It's really a house of cards built out of garbage and chewing gum. If this works at all, it'll be a miracle. So we're going to try and detect changes between these p-hashes, right? And a p-hash, or a Hamming distance, the thing we're going to use to detect these changes, is in information theory, the Hamming distance between two strings of equal length is the number of positions at which the corresponding symbols are different. From Wikipedia, again, accurate, but so is differentiness. This is the differentiness of the two things, right? If you guys need any other definitions, just look me up. I'm on Twitter. I'm happy to help. We're just talking about the differentiness between these two strings, right? So if we have this little 8-bit number and then this other one, the difference is 1, right? It's how many transformations we have to make on the top number to get to the bottom number, right? So the same is true here, then. If we take the top and we compare to the bottom, we'd have to change 3 different things to get to the bottom. That's the Hamming distance. These two numbers have a Hamming distance of 3. Okay. Now, interestingly, if you're looking at an image like this, it takes rather a lot of change for 10 of these to flip to the other side, right? Because we take the mean and we're comparing the colors in each of those cells over the top. Rather, a lot has to change in an image to get to a Hamming distance of 10. So if we cut off at 10, we know that we're likely looking at something else. And now, the perceptual hashes, it should be noted, are not unique, right? This perceptual hash could describe lots of different things at full scale. It could be a donut, or it could be an Eye of Sauron, right? They may have similar, but if you take a donut and you suddenly turn it into a duck, this is going to notice. We're going to get the duck donut conversion, right? All right, so let's talk about the responsibilities of the all-seeing Pi here. So the all-seeing Pi, again, is the gem running on the Raspberry Pi. It takes the pictures from the camera, and it uploads them to the cloud, and then it notifies Palantir. It hits it over the API and says, hey, Palantir, a thing happened. Right? It creates an image, basically. It's a create endpoint. It just creates an image in Palantir. So that's all of the responsibilities for the Pi. And these are the responsibilities for Palantir now. So Palantir has got the UI in there. So we can have a look at what's going on in the app. And we're constantly refreshing from a little API endpoint to get the latest image, pulling in a little bit of JavaScript so we can show on the page the latest image that pops up. In addition to that, Palantir is responsible for comparing the p-hashes. It has to take those p-hash values. It doesn't have to have the images locally, which is nice, because it got the p-hashes from the all-seeing Pi, and it just compares them as they come in. And if the new one that just came in is too different than the last one that it has, then it knows to raise an alert. And when it raises an alert, it detects that something is too different. It's going to go up to the cloud, and it's going to create its own alert bucket. So up in the cloud, we have one pile of images that is all of the images for the Palantir, and it's being depleted. They go through and it deletes images as it goes, so the bucket doesn't grow unbounded, right? But then off to the side, we have this event pile of images. And once an event happens, we take all the images that are over here, there's 10 of them, they get rotated, and we move them over to the event. We say, all right, well, now an event has happened, and we've got these 10 images over here. Anytime a new image comes in from the Pi, then we put it in the event bucket, up to 100. We assume that most events will finish in 100 images. And these are all configurable, of course. So then the final thing that the Palantir does is it notifies me. It sends a tweet to me and lets me know that Sauron is in the house, and he's after the knives, right? So once we're done, it has to go and clean up those images. That deletion that I was talking about, that's Palantir's responsibility. So a Pi running unchecked will just fill a bucket to infinity, and I'll get a $16,000 S3 bill. Maybe that's a design flaw. I don't know. Depends on how you're looking at it. And then we have the responsibilities of the cloud. What does the cloud do in our app? Nothing. It's a cloud. It sits there. And the Amazon cloud says, I can do stuff. And I say, no. Right? Because the Amazon cloud has these like messaging services, and it could have solved my little queue problem. It would have been great, right? But then you're kind of locked to that provider. And that's also why I stopped using this gem, this AWS SDK gem. Well, part of the reason. So I started out using this to deal with the S3, where I was creating the buckets and uploading the images. And it was quite handy in the beginning, and I was recording my requests with VCR. I'm sure people have used VCR, a fantastic tool for that kind of thing. If you have to record requests and replay them in your tests, you can do that, but I would much rather not if I have the option. And it turns out that you do, because there's this gem called Fog, which is terribly difficult for me to understand when I try to read the code, but I don't care, because I don't read the code very often. I just get to use the code in this case. Actually, it's not that bad on the inside. The last time I looked at it was a couple years ago, and so when I went back now, it's changed significantly. But Fog is fantastic, and the really nice thing about Fog is I don't have to use VCR. I can use Fog mocks. So you turn on Fog mock, and then you get your own little pretend S3, and you can just talk to your pretend S3 in your tests, and you can check that things actually got stored there. And it's much easier than having to replay cassettes and delete cassettes and track these giant YAML files of everything that happened. Again, I'm not knocking VCR. VCR is fantastic. If you have to do that thing, then you should definitely use VCR. And so when I was making this conversion, I went into my image service. I was very clever, and I encapsulated this in an image service inside my app. And I deleted the AWS gem, and I put the Fog gem in there, and I just had to change the client and like a couple methods where I was talking to it through its public API, and then I was done, and it worked great, right? But then I switched all of the VCR tests over to using mocks, and while I was doing that, I noticed that I'd been using these kind of like Portland artisanal objects throughout my tests, right? And I wanted to fabricate them instead, so I put the fabrication gem in there, and I started fabricating objects so I could create them in kind of a reliably random way. And in order to do that, I've got Faker in there, and so it's now creating my new objects, and suddenly I'm lost in a very deep, dark wood, because I've just changed many things about my application and how it functions, and I spent two very sad days with just broken app and red tests, and everything was terrible, and it would never be okay again, and I want to just stop as an aside here real quick to point out that you should only ever do one thing ever in your applications. I feel like I've been doing this a relatively long time, and I have to relearn this lesson with every day, probably. Like, oh yeah, I was just going to do the one thing, but then I was fixing, and then the other thing, right? And you think, oh, I can just do these two things. No, you cannot do two things. Do not do two things, right? You're like, no, they come in twos. No, they do not. Do one thing, all right? And by doing one thing, you will avoid spending 2 days in the sad forest of sad. It was terrible. But I fixed it, and then the forest was beautiful, and I came out into the sunshine, and my application was working again, and I had green tests, and I got to add some more things. So one of those things I added was the API I talked about. I have to have an API. I decided to use Grape to implement the API. Maybe not the choice that anyone here would have made or not. I don't know. Grape's actually kind of fun to use. I enjoy it. And I had to learn it for work because we were adding instrumentation for Grape. So two birds, one stone. So I have this API, and the browser is able to hit this API to get the latest image, right? This one function there. And then the Pi is going to create the images. It's going to send us a post to create an image in Palantir when we get a new image from the Pi. So this is basically our diagram. Our architecture diagram at this point is Pi sends a post, and then Palantir to everything, okay? And I'm going to describe everything here for you. Because keep it simple is really pretty important to me when I try to build things, right? Like I try to keep the Pi very simple. So naturally, when you're keeping it simple, I'm sure we're all thinking the same thing. You want to use Rails callbacks as much as possible, right? You want to just stack these bad boys in there. Just callbacks on callbacks on callbacks. You can see where this is going. I still can't believe that this train is a real thing. It's so awesome. Somebody please get a Lord of the Rings train. Give me a ride. So the new image comes in, right? We send this post over here, and Palantir has to create this event, right? Sometimes. We don't always create the event, but if the differentiness is too much, then we create an event, right? So we've got this little callback when those images come in. We create the event, maybe, conditionally, right? And then we also have to copy new images to an event. So a new image comes in. We have to create the event if we don't already have one. If we do have one, then we copy the image that was just delivered to us over to the event that's ongoing, right? Assuming that event is still open. So it's pretty reasonable, okay? Images also will delete the oldest images, so we get that rotation I was talking about where we go through and drop the last image, those 10 images. So we've got these callbacks on an image, right? Three, not terrible. Let's talk about the event here. When we create an event needs a name, right? The event has to have a name that's unique across all of S3, so it gets its own little bucket name. We generate a directory name for it when we're created. And then we actually have to create that directory as well, right? So we go up there to S3 and we hit the cloud and we create that directory. And when we create that directory, we've got the callback here. We've generated the directory name. We've got a callback to create the directory. Then we've got to copy the existing images, those 10 images, over to the created directory, right? In case there was something there we want to keep track of. So now we've got three on the image and three on the event. We're still going. And now we assign the last image that came in to the event so we can keep track of the image that started the event. So finally, we send a notification off to me on the internet, and we have five callbacks for the event, and we're keeping it simple, right? I mean, all that happens is this right here when the event comes in. You hit the API, and then these eight things go. So if I were to do this again, I would probably choose anything else ever. It was really terrible. And maybe it's just because I'm bad at Rails. I'll admit, like, I mostly live in the Ruby world, and I work with Ruby all day, and I don't get to play with Rails very often. But, man, this was terrible. So if you have recommendations of alternative ways to do that thing, that'd be great. Why don't we talk later? I surely could come up with some manager object in there or something. Basically, like, I consider using callbacks in that way that I'm, like, hiding the existence of some business object that I really need, or maybe an event system anyway. So I want to tell you how you can get a Sauron, if anyone is interested in having a Sauron of their very own. Has anyone noticed if the little red light is blinking up here? It's blinking at you? Sauron is winking. He loves you. Okay. So if you want a Sauron of your own, they're actually really pretty easy to get. You can pay $40 to these nice people who make this awesome hardware, and you should pay them $40 for no reason. But if you happen to, they will give you this thing, which is awesome. And this actually pictured is not the correct one, but they'll give you an A and a camera for $40. It's a pretty good deal. And then you can go and you can get the web app, Palantir. Feel free to mock my code privately. Keep your thoughts to yourself. It's terrible and I feel bad. But no, actually, if you want to make pull requests, that'd be great. Constructive criticism. I also have another app out there, another repo. This is the Palantir repo. I'm leadbot on GitHub as well. Good luck. And this is All Seeing Eye. That's the repo that is All Seeing Pi, but didn't get renamed when I changed the name over. I'll rename it later today when I get back out there. So with that, I think we should probably start a live demo, of course, using these two application components and the cloud and the Wi-Fi, and everything will go fine, I'm sure. So if we look over here, let's see if I can escape out of this. And now I need to unmirror. How do I unmirror? Someone knows this. Is Command F1 is a thing? Oh, it is. Did I do it? First try. God, I'm so smart. Okay. Hey, look! It's you on the internet! Hooray! Okay. So we've been taking pictures of you here. Over in, and Eric's moving into the cloud, and I hope it didn't catch you, because it may have triggered an event. So what the image is doing now, it's taking pictures of you over here in this side of the crowd. And it's comparing them one after another and dumping them into a new event. There's Eric, just jumped in there. And those that new event that gets triggered happens by too much change in the image. So I'm going to give it another couple images here to get Eric out of there. And we're going to look at like normal image right now. Okay, this is our training. Now, in order to do this, it has an event already that's open, and it's saving images to it. So I need to go and close that event. So I'm also just going to hop in here to this console on Heroku, live, because I have to. And there's my event, and it is not closed, so I'm going to close it. I'm going to set this last event to closed. So remember that an event is created when two images are too different, right? And so if I were to have just turned this thing on, it would have taken the image from the hallway where I was testing it before my presentation and compared it to the image of you right now and immediately fired an event, which is obviously not what I wanted to happen. What I want to happen is I want to save this event and close it, and now the new images are coming in, and this should assume that everything is fine for now. It's not going to detect that there's been too big a change in the image, because it's just looking at pretty much the same thing when it smashes it down to that little 8x8 pixel image, right? So now, if you all would please stand up and give more of a Friday hug gesture than you are giving now, and we will try to change the information significantly enough and see if a picture loads. We're waiting. There's a picture of you still not moving, waiting on our API. Probably a couple images have been taken now, and this looks pretty different to me. This room is not at all committed over here. This side is like, you guys are nuts. I am not going to be involved in your tomfoolery. And it looks like we don't have our new image. Okay. Did it blink? Did the red light blink at you? All right. Oh, well. Well, I'm going to let you guys sit down then. I tried, but I'll show you what would have happened in an event normally. How's that? So we have these images coming in, and down at the bottom of our application here, we have some events that I took earlier. Like, let's see, here's one. And when the events are created, they are populated with all of the images copied over as they come in. And you can see that they line out all of the images as they pop up. And I'm really sad that we didn't get it to change. Why won't you change? I'm just going to put a thing in front of it here and see if it'll ever take a picture again. If it does, it'll get a picture of my badge, and then it will tweet a thing. So the idea is it's taking pictures of you now sitting back down again. It just didn't like the differentiness. Okay, well, let's go back to the talk here. So that's the app. That's the app of Palantir where the images have been uploaded, and we have pictures coming in from the hallway. It'll be out there again later today if you guys want to come by and play with it. And this is, let's see here, the future of this app. Step one, make it work. Oh, yeah, I think that's, someone is tweeting at me on the internet, and I had the Twitter open. I should go and turn off Twitter right now, actually, because you guys are a bunch of jerks, and I know better than to do that, yeah. Yeah, I know, right? Okay. the bit where it didn't work just now, I think I have to figure out, first of all. But it does notice when things have changed in the image, and maybe we changed too many things, I don't know. But that's the first step. And also, we're going to have a faster setup process in the future. So getting this thing rolling is actually quite difficult. You have to deploy the Palantir app to someplace online, and then you have to get an API key out of it and put it onto the Raspberry Pi, and you're like SSHing into the Pi and manually adding config files. And I think I could simplify that whole process quite significantly. The other bit, of course, is that we have a lot of data now about images and Hamming distances, and we could store all of that stuff and probably learn from it. So you could learn times of day when things were an anomaly or not, or you could learn what particular things in the image happen to look like. Like maybe you're triggering your hamming distance on your cat, but the cat always triggers the hamming distance in the same way because it walks along the floor on the bottom. And so you could learn to ignore those types of things, right? And finally, as I mentioned, I would like to fix everything in the app there. This is also the camera bit that I'm using is particularly slow. So the Raspi still utility that comes on the Pi takes pictures about a second apart, and it takes a long time. But then I have to push it up over the API, and there's a faster way to do it. There's an app called, or a utility called Raspi Fast CamD, which is a demonized version of the camera that you just send a user signal to, and it'll take a picture. And it can take pictures like sub 10 milliseconds. So I can take many, many pictures very fast and upload them as quickly as I take them. And they do end up being quite small. Plus, I get to have a demon inside of my Lord of the Rings application here. So thank you all very much for coming. It was a pleasure. This is Eric earlier on the camera when it was emitting events. And I will leave you staring at my Palantir app here, or not, because I can't get it up. I guess I have rather a lot of time. Am I mistaken? Did I go really quick? If anyone had any questions about how this thing went together, now would be a good time. Yes, sir?
The knives. What happened to the knives?
I'm going to call it done. Thank you all so much for coming.